Well, this morning, I thought I'd do something a little different. We looked at all the parables, Jesus's parables in the New Testament. We went through, I don't know, it was 34, 35 parables. But I thought this morning, let's maybe try to look through some parables in the Old Testament, and let me just see what I can find here. Well, not like when we were in the New Testament, where I went through 34, 35 parables. In this case, we're only going to look at nine parables, so I don't know how many lessons it'll take, but I always try to keep my lessons around 30 minutes, so keep your attention span. Well, these are the nine parables that I thought we'd look at, and I won't go through them right now, but we'll take them one at a time, and we'll go through them. And the first one, I seeing that it deals with the sin of David and Nathan coming and telling him about the poor man with the ewe lamb and related it to his sin. It's actually self-explanatory what the meaning of the parable was. And I guess we can apply it to our lives like everything else in Scripture, but I'd like to look at David's sin, first of all, and maybe we can look at it with a kind of a drawing illustration. This is a good ministry out there, and let's just look real quickly. It's about a one-minute video, so let's just take a look at it once.
Things go horribly wrong. David makes a fatal mistake. Not fatal for him, but for a man named Uriah, one of David's prized soldiers. So from his rooftop, David sees Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, bathing. David finds her, he sleeps with her, gets her pregnant, and then he tries to cover the whole thing up by having Uriah assassinated and then marrying her. It's just horrible. So when David's confronted by the prophet Nathan about all of this, he immediately owns up to what he's done. He's broken, he repents, he asks God to forgive him, and God does forgive him, but God doesn't erase the consequences of David's decisions. And so as a result of this horrible choice, David's family, his kingdom, it all falls apart, and it makes this section a tragic story, much like Saul's.
Before we get into the parable itself, I found this video, and I'm going to play it, and it's a little bit longer. It's 10 minutes, but it's entitled, Did Bathsheba Lure David into Immorality? In other words, was Bathsheba part of the problem with the sin? Before we actually go in. And the reason I want to do this is I want to illustrate how we can be tempted to sin. And it's very easy. And Satan uses trickery, will sometimes get us to sin, and that we have to pay the consequences for that sin. It isn't that we get off scot-free, by no means. When we sin, there's a price to be paid. Even though it says the wages of sin is death, and Christ had died for the wages of sin, we still pay the consequences for sin in our lives. Like in David, it ruined his life. But the question is here, did Bathsheba lure David into immorality? Let's just look at that video here. Let me just switch screens here. Okay, and I will start the video.
Let's go to this. Let's go to 2 Samuel 11, because I thought this question was very interesting. And if everyone hadn't spent so much time asking the questions last week, this is what I would have said. No, not really. I'm teasing you. This was a good question. Did both of them sin? Yes. Clearly. I mean, Bathsheba was not raped. It doesn't ever say that. So they were. It was agreeable between them. But look at what God emphasized. See, this is what's interesting. The answer to this question is, what does God emphasize? We have the record of God watching the events unfold. What did he choose to write down? See, that's what the repetitive reading of the scriptures slowly does to us. We start seeing life from God's perspective. What is it that the Lord picks out? I mean, if you go, our guide in Israel that we've had for 25 years or 20-some years died at Mother's Day of this year, and so we had a new guide that I'd never met before, never knew anything about. In fact, it was a lady whose name was Zipporah, like right out of, like Moses' wife, you know, Zipporah. And so here, you know, we're meeting her, and it was so fascinating after all these years ago in the Holy Land to hear what she pointed out and what she didn't. And I didn't know anything about her, and the first day I was kind of watching her, you know, I was doing my part, she was doing hers. And finally I said, could you tell me a little bit about yourself? She said, well, yeah. She says, my father trained all the tour guides in Israel for 40 years. And she said, my husband's the general over all the Israeli intelligence. She says, why do you ask? I said, because you see something different in these sites than I've ever heard anybody point out. And you learn from people what they point out and what they don't. What did God, look at 2 Samuel 11. It says, verse 1, David remained in Jerusalem. David knew well that temptations often strike when we're alone and when things aren't on the normal schedule. Verse 2, and it happened one evening. Unscheduled time, random time is always dangerous. He arose and walked on the roof of his house. He already knew that he could look everywhere, and it's evening, and people always came in at the end of the day and had, you know, they're getting ready for, you know, supper and all the bathing that Israelites were supposed to do. And from the roof, he saw this woman. He's totally undisciplined. And what's interesting is the end of verse 2, it says she was beautiful to behold. Do you know what that word behold means? To continuously watch. I remember when I was at Bob Jones University that old Dr. Bob, one of them, the first or the second, always said, you can't stop, I forget what kind of bird he called it, crows from flying over your head, but you sure can stop them from making a nest. I thought, well, that's a curious statement. But what he's saying is this. Almost anybody could, you know, just curiously walk up, glance over the edge and go, whoa, that's not something I should be looking at, and walk away. But she was beautiful to stare at. And so, verse 3, look what happens. David is see what God's pointing out? The Lord is pointing out how many hurdles David went over. He blew off the schedule. Kings go to war at this time. He blew off the schedule that you don't walk around at night. You know, it's kind of like your neighbors don't forget to close their curtains. You don't take advantage of that as it gets dark and the lights go on in the house. You learn the propriety. But David, you just blew by all those. But look at verse 3. So David sent and inquired about the woman, and someone said, isn't this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah, the Hittite? What they kind of gave her full documentation. They said, don't you know who this is? I mean, as if he didn't. They give her pedigree, ending with, she's married, David, to one of your secret service agents, your bodyguards. You know who that is. She's married. See, that was a guardrail. And David pushes right over the guardrail. And David sent multiple messengers. I mean, this guy is unashamed and unheeding and uncaring, sends her home. And then look at verse 6. Send me Uriah the Hittite. He tries to cover his sin. You see, yeah, they both sinned. But God points out David's sin more than Bathsheba's. Why? That's very interesting to think about. And I immediately came to this. God looks at how much we know. Think about Deuteronomy 17. The Lord said, David, don't you remember when you're copying your copy of the Bible? You're not supposed to think yourself above anybody else. You're not supposed to think you deserve whatever you want. You're not supposed to think you're special. You know, our culture, everybody's special. Yeah, and some people act like it. And they think they're better. And they David, no, be humble. That's what gets God's attention. And look at the very last verse of chapter 11, verse 27, the last sentence. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Now think about it. That's all that matters in life. You know, I have a personal operating system that I filter everything through. I really have a very simple life. I have two goals: please God and do what he left me to do, make disciples. Where's the please God from? Right here. What David did displeased the Lord. It doesn't say he broke commandment number, you know, seven, you know, adultery. It doesn't say that. It says the whole thing displeased the Lord. And we don't want to do that. See, that's what love does. You don't want to displease the one. And David knew. I don't know how much Bathsheba knew about the Lord. She was married to a Hittite, someone from Anatolia, from, you know, Turkey, from that area. I mean, the Hittite Empire. She married a foreigner. David knew God. So the Lord, well, look at this, Luke 12:48 with me for a minute, and I'll finish off on this question. I mean, there's so much more we could ponder, but Luke 12, I hope I typed the right one. 12:48, whoop, I'm not on the right one. Oh, here we go. He who does not know yet committed things deserving stripes shall be beaten with few, and everyone who much is given, for him much will be required, and to whom much has been committed, of him they will ask the more. You see the principle that the Lord says, David, you knew Deuteronomy 17, you knew so much more, you knew me, and I threw in front of you barrier after barrier. I sent you to war, and I sent a servant who stood up to you and said, you shouldn't be walking around looking over that, and that's a married woman. And you just plowed through all that. And so much is going to be required of you. And if you notice, God, if we had gone through 2 Samuel 12, did you know that the penalty for stealing was that you had to repay fourfold? That's why they didn't have a lot of, they didn't have 3 million people in jail like we do in America. If you stole something, you had to work for the person that you stole from until you repaid four times what you stole. I mean, there was capital punishment, God instituted that, but if you didn't do something worthy of capital punishment, you, through hard labor, managed by the person, I mean, you had to kind of get to know the person that harmed you, and there's just so much wisdom in all that. So David stole the life of Uriah. And so God said, you're going to repay fourfold. Bathsheba's firstborn child is going to die. And then Ammon is going to die. And Absalom is going to die. And Adonijah is going to die. And you're going to pay four times for the one life you took. You know what David said? Okay. See, that's why the Lord required so much of him. He knew so much, and he was responsive. And I could go on that one.
Okay, now we get the background on this story before going into the parable that Nathan told to David. And we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 12, and we're going to start with the very first verse. And now remember, this story that we just looked at was the reason that Nathan had to rebuke David. So let's just look at it.
Chapter 12. And the Lord sent Nathan to David. He came to him and said to him, there were two men in a certain city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had very many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought, And he brought it up, and it grew up with him and with his children. It used to eat of his morsel and drink from his cup and lie in his arms, and it was like a daughter to him. Now there came a traveler to the rich man, and he was unwilling to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the guest who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. Then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die, and he shall restore the lamb fourfold, because he did this thing, and because he had no pity." Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you out of the hand of Saul, and I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your arms, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if this were too little, I would add to you as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord, to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me, and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, Behold, I will raise up evil against you out of your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes, and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." And Nathan said to David, "The Lord also has put away your sin. You shall not die. Nevertheless, because by this deed you have utterly scorned the Lord, the child who is born to you shall die." Then Nathan went to his house.
We'll stop our reading right there. It's kind of a sad picture that the king of Israel, David, committed this sin. But, you know, it tells us in the Bible that David was a man after God's own heart. And a great a man as David was in the nation Israel back then, just think about this for a minute. We can fall in to sin just as quickly as David did. And I think there's a lot of circumstances that led up to the fall of David. He disregarded the word of God. He disregarded all the helps that God had sent his way to stop him from sinning, as we've seen in that video that we just watched prior to reading the scripture. So the only thing that God could do was send Nathan to David, the prophet Nathan, to tell him this story. And it brought out in David's heart the evil that this man did with this ewe lamb, but it also brought out the evil which was in his own heart. Let me ask you this. Do you know how much evil is in your heart? Do you know what the capabilities that you could perform? We are being tempted every day. You turn on your television, you watch something that you shouldn't watch, and it stimulates not just your mind, but your heart. And it says, even in the Bible, that our hearts, we can conceive so much evil in our hearts. And we can be just like David. We can sin against God. I'm going to take you to one more scripture, and that is the confession of Jesus, the confession of David when he sinned against God, and he pours his heart out to God. It's called repentance, and I want you to see a heart of repentance. I'm going to turn in the scripture, so I'm just going to pause this for a minute and then switch scriptures. If you'd like, you could turn in your Bibles to Psalms 51. I've got it up here, and I'm going to do the audio again. And this is the psalm that David wrote after he had realized that he had sinned against God with Bathsheba. So let's just listen to David's heart as he wrote this psalm.
Psalm 51. To the choir master, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words, and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then will you delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar.
And we will stop our reading at the end of this psalm. I read the old psalm for this reason. You can see true repentance in David. I would like to maybe end this lesson. Just get back to the main screen here. Maybe end this lesson right here. So I hope that we learned a great lesson from this parable of the little ewe lamb, that we learned how much evil is in our own hearts. When we hear that parable of how this man took this one little ewe lamb and killed it, it's like killing somebody's pet, and with no remorse or anything, and yet he didn't have to do it. And David didn't have to commit the sin either with Bathsheba. It was a choice that he made, and we choose to sin. And the Bible calls that willful sin. We willfully sin against God, even knowing when something is wrong, we do it. That is how much evil is in our own hearts. That's why Christ had to die for our sins. So the next time you're tempted to sin, the Bible says flee from it. I mean, run from it. Don't dilly-dally. Don't wait around for sin to take hold. It's not a sin to be tempted, but it's a sin to fall into that temptation knowing that God has provided a way out. And he has. He's given you a new heart if you're a Christian, and you don't have to sin. So when we know that we're sinning, stop immediately and flee. That's the message that we have from this one parable today. And we covered one parable in this lesson, and that's all we need to cover, because there's a great lesson in it for all of us. Let's pray. Lord, as we go through life, we know we're tempted, Lord. Sin is all around us. We live in a very sinful world. Temptations approach us every day, Lord. Lord, may we just be occupied with your word. May we hide your word in our hearts that we may not sin against you. Lord, we are evil by nature, Lord, and we live in a very evil world. And it's so easy to be just like David and fall into sin and then try to cover up our sin, Lord, like David did. It's so wrong, Lord. And yet we are capable of doing this, Lord. And Lord, may we just draw close to you, stay in your word, and just be occupied with you, Lord, until either we go home or you come to take us home, Lord. We just pray this now in your wonderful name. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.